today's video, we will move on to computational modeling of host-pathogen interactions. There are many methods to do it, and practically all the techniques studied in the course so far, such as constraint-based modeling or Boolean networks or graph theory, can be used to model host-pathogen interactions. So, I will give you a brief overview of the methods and then go over to how we model MTB host interactions using Boolean networks, and I will talk about how we went about reconstructing this model.
What is a pathogen?
It is a disease causing organism, and it interacts with a host, right? It basically infects a host, right? So, what happens when a host is infected by a pathogen?
There is an interplay of several processes, right?
There is, if you will, there is a host signaling, a host regulation, a host metabolism, a pathogen signaling, a pathogen regulation, a pathogen metabolism, and you know, they are all intertwined. There is a lot of interaction that goes on. And what do you think is, if you are talking about if the host is human, what do you think is the most important component of this interaction? What is the one human system that is very important in this interaction? The immune system, right? So, the immune system is going to be extremely active, a major player orchestrating the entire response to any kind of host. So, today we will look at an example of tuberculosis and with a particular case study, but otherwise I will also try to outline some generic strategies to model host-pathogen interactions. So, how do we model host-pathogen interactions? So, there are people who have studied protein-protein interactions between the host and the pathogen. So, there is a protein interaction network in the host, there is a protein interaction network in the pathogen, and you can imagine that there are some interactions that cross over the organisms, right, across the boundaries, right. There is a host pathogen which interacts with the pathogen protein and vice versa. There are models, very nice models of the dynamics of the immune system itself. This is somewhat similar to your SIR models as well. So, you have a differential equation based modeling of the immune system dynamics and so on, very interesting models. Similarly, mechanistic models of the immune system, various cells, you know, what happens to B cells, what happens to T cells, so on and so forth. Agent based modeling, again, you know, very powerful methodology for studying these kinds of cells. So, you model every single cell as an agent. So, there are some rules governing its interaction with other agents, other species, other cells and so on. As of course, constraint based modeling, which obviously is going to underline mostly the metabolism of the interaction, right. So, there is some dependence between the host metabolism and the pathogen metabolism. This is actually very interesting. There are some organisms which are really smart. So, when they infect a host, they shut down some of their own metabolic machinery. I'm going to stop producing tryptophan because now I can take it from the host. So, they will start expressing transporter proteins for tryptophan rather than actually synthesizing tryptophan themselves, you know, much easier, right, much lesser energy expended that way. And of course, Boolean network modeling that we were seeing in the previous lecture, right. How can we exploit Boolean network modeling towards understanding host-pathogen interactions? And there is a very nice review that appeared in 2013, which covers a very large spectrum of these methods, right. And you can imagine there are every technique that we have studied in the course so far could potentially be applied to the host-pathogen scenario. Nothing stopping you from doing that. Right. So, if you want to apply networks, you want to apply dynamics, you want to apply constraint based modeling, you want to apply Boolean networks, all of these are potentially useful in the context of host pathogen systems biology. So, and it is important to construct systems level models of host pathogen interactions, because you can't, as we have discussed through the course, you can't get sufficient insights from a very narrow model, right, by just looking at one pathway in the host or one pathway in the bacterium or pathogen and so on. So, let us look at Boolean network modeling of human Mycobacterium tuberculosis interactions. So, how does the infection happen? So, TB organism enters the human body via the respiratory tract. Once inside the lungs, there is a major interplay. It is a very interesting cat and mouse game that goes on. So, that is the first immune response by the host. It is not necessarily the first immune response and so on. There is an immune response by the host, there is a defense by the pathogen, there is a counter response by the host and literally a counter response by the pathogen, right. It is actually they keep exchanging blows. There are different molecules, different species and molecular species in both host and pathogen involved in this, you know, very interesting game. We will see how this goes on, right. So, sometimes if you are very lucky, you could have no infection, all is well. Right. But then you can have infection and have no symptoms, and then you can have disease where you have all the symptoms of tuberculosis and so on. And this can really, you know, this is a very common outcome of tuberculosis infection. So it is just in latent infection, or what is known as persistence. The disease just persists, or you know, the organism just persists without causing active disease. It could manifest in disease at some point. So you do have, the organism is in you, but it doesn't like really, you know.
So interaction is going there.
Yeah. So it doesn't you know, cause all the
symptoms.
The symptoms, right? It doesn't. Or in some sense you can say it is not a, it is only an infection but not a disease. You can see the difference between the two, right? Disease is like you know, a state of being ill. Infection is you have the organism in your body, but it is not yet causing major damage, right? So the initial host response may be completely effective and get rid of the bacillus, which is an ideal outcome, right? Or the organisms can grow and multiply immediately after infection, resulting in active disease, serious disease. Or the bacilli may be dormant and literally not do anything at all. This is the case in, this is a case in, you know, very common scenario, especially for tuberculosis. In fact, there are people who have been suggesting strategies of trying to kick the bacterium out of persistence so that it can actually be treated. In a sense, cause disease so that the disease may be treated, because the latent infection is just you know, dormant and untargetable. Or this is something that can happen. So the latent bacillus can actually become active later on and finally progress to the regular disease condition, stage 2, the condition 2. So how can we model the complex web of interactions that exist between TB and human? Essentially the bacterial, you know, metabolism and signaling versus human immune system, right? So human immune system is the major player here. So this was a strategy that we adopted. We basically, you always have to build these models from literature. So we went through a lot of literature on host Mycobacterium tuberculosis interactions and identified several components and interactions. So we came up with 75 nodes with around you know, including bacteria, 18 virulence factors, 56 host components including 11 cellular processes, 26 molecules and 19 cells and cell states. So this could be like T cells and activated T cells, B cells and activated B cells, they are all different states. And build a network and then, you know, identify all the Boolean transfer functions as we discussed in the previous class, initialize the node states and then simulate the network. And we had some semi-quantitative variables as well, which helped us figure out what was the outcome. So we said if you know, the amount of bacteria goes beyond a particular threshold, we say it's active disease, right? Or if bacteria stay within a particular zone for a long time, it enters persistence. Or if bacteria is like very low, you know, you just have like a few bacteria after a few days of infection, then it's essentially been conquered by the immune system, right? And how does this look? This is how complex the system looks. So we have a whole lot of different cells, cell states, species, molecules and so on. I'll try to zoom into a part of it. Yeah. So this is the bacterium out here and it interacts with macrophages, neutrophils, activated neutrophils, dendritic cells, activated dendritic cells, activated phagocytic cells, pro-inflammatory cytokines, these are chemicals, reactive oxygen and nitrogen intermediates, T cells that could be either naive or activated, TH1 cells, TH17 cells, gamma delta T cells, the whole battery of immune system components. Really very interesting set of interactions, and all these are bacterial proteins and so on. So SOD, SAK2, SOD-C, BPOB, MANLAM. MANLAM is an important polysaccharide which is secreted by it's lipoaminomannan, LAM stands for, and this interacts with, this helps the organism trick the host and so on and so forth. And all these IL stuff that you see here, they are all interleukins. They are signaling molecules used in the human system. So essentially there are about 75 nodes including bacterial defense, host innate and adaptive immunity. Do you know what is innate and adaptive immunity? So innate immunity is sort of the de facto response to any infection. And adaptive is a more tailored response. Usually happens once you have, in a sense, we're loosely speaking, calibrated to the infection. So, what happens when you have a vaccine? You already surmount an adaptive response, which is why vaccines work when they work, right? So you already have seen this organism before, right? So most of us must have had those BCG shots, right? So which is actually the TB vaccine, right? So you have now seen a weaker version of TB, so you can respond adapted to the TB infection. Right. So, the adaptive immune machinery has more different components that come into play and so on, right. You can read about this, is really quite interesting. We essentially built the model from published literature, and using this picture, which is essentially a condensation of all the knowledge that is contained in about 100, 120 papers, you now have to frame the transfer functions, right. So, when is bacteria active? When does phagocytosis kick in, when does antigen presentation work out, so on and so forth, right. And there is an element of chance in some of these as well, so which we basically take care by using a random variable, right. And you will see that all this works very nicely with Boolean net that we saw in the previous lab. So, this is a sample of our transfer function. How does it look like? So, bacteria update rule is bacteria resides only in macrophage or activated phagocytic cells, but it should not be exposed to ROI or RNA or cathelicidin or other inflammatory molecules, or bacteria and it should phagolysosome formation or apoptosis should not have set in, right. So, things like that. So, basically the text is given below. So, bacteria remain viable in macrophage or antigen present activated phagocytic cells in the absence of phagolysosome formation, apoptosis or molecules such as ROIs, RNIs, cathelicidin and other inflammatory molecules, right. Antigen presentation follows antigen processing, and there is a bit of uncertainty in this process, which is encapsulated as random. So, a random element is basically true or false 50% of the time, right. If we had a better idea, if you knew a probability, you could encode it too, right. So, this, as I said, goes back to the strength of a discrete modeling framework. You can just easily integrate whatever function you want here and so on. Okay. So, TH1 cells are important in the control of TB infection as they produce a cytokines interferon gamma and tumor necrosis factor alpha. So, T cells in the presence of bacteria upon stimulation by interleukin 12 or 18 differentiate into these TH1 cells. And macrophages in the presence of chemokines further increase the population of TH1 cells, right. So, if you see here, TH1 cells will be true if macrophage and chemokine signaling are there, or if bacteria and T cells and these interleukins are present and so on. So, this basically tries to encapsulate all the biology that you see here in terms of a Boolean function. One more example. So, phagocytosis of bacteria and the subsequent signaling activates the phagocytic cells. Alternatively, there are pro-inflammatory cytokines TCRC and cytokines released by the T cells such as IL-1 and so on, which in synergy can activate the phagocytic cells. Chemokine signaling also stimulates macrophage to recruit activated phagocytic cells. But if you see, this is actually quite easy if somebody is given you this. So, the model construction reconstruction happens in this part, and this is hard work, involves lot of literature mining and reading and so on. So, in this video we had a brief overview of the methods for modeling host pathogen interactions, and we also looked at how we construct a Boolean model of the interactions between Mycobacterium tuberculosis and the human host. In the next video, we will look at how to go ahead performing the simulations with this model and derive interesting conclusions.